Thank you, friends. Welcome to this unique Indo-UK initiative, first of its kind. On day one, 15th of October, today in the colorectal session, we are going to now discuss the panel discussion on challenges in management of rectal cancer. I am your moderator for today, Dr. Deep Goyal. I am a senior director and consultant robotic GI surgeon in Delhi from India. And I have a panelist who are power-packed. Dr. Gina Brown from UK. I'm very sure she does not need an introduction. I am personally a huge fan of her works. She has single-handedly changed the way we stage rectal cancer today. Dr. Sharath Karandikar is another friend and a very eminent colorectal surgeon from UK. Dr. Muhammad Abdullah Al Mamoon, again a close friend and very well-known, renowned, skilled surgeon, colorectal surgeon from Bangladesh. And another friend, Dr. Paleswan Joshi, who is again very skilled, not only a surgeon and a brilliant academician from Kathmandu, Nepal. And then last but not the least, Dr. Surupa Mitra, again a friend who is a very eminent radiation oncologist respected in this part of the world from New Delhi. Welcome everybody. Thank you very much. And without wasting much time, I will like to start. As all of us know that, you know, rectal cancer surgery is very, very glamorous, and various people have contributed vastly to this, starting from Sir William Mice in early 1900s when he first proposed the APR, to Gina Brown, who has sort of invented how MRI helps in staging and then sets the ball rolling for multidisciplinary treatment for rectal cancer. And between there are all stalwarts, and I had the fortune of working with Professor Heald very, very shortly. This is Mr. Jacobs, who did the first laparoscopy collect me in 1991. These are some of the events which have been, you know, game changer in the history of rectal cancer treatment, starting from MRI, new and adjuvant CTRT, sharp dissection, sphincter preservation, and the modern technology in the form of staplers, energy sources, and indocyanine green. As we know that proper staging for any cancer is important, and that is what will decide the course of the treatment, and this can't be more true than rectal cancer treatment. If you do not properly stage the treatment, it is sometimes difficult to decide the sequence and the modalities of treatment, which could be surgery, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, either one of them or all of them in combinations. So it is imperative for us to know the proper staging before we can give a final verdict to the patient that what is going to be the sequence of the treatment. So I will start by asking Dr. Gina Brown the first question. What is the role of MRI in pre-treatment local staging, Gina?
Okay, so there are quite a few items of information that the radiology MRI can provide for the surgeon, and as well as the multidisciplinary team to plan the treatment. So the first thing is, of course, you localize the tumor on the MRI, the height of the tumor and its relationship to the sphincter. That's very important, as you would all be aware. So by measuring the lowest margin of the tumor to the top of the puborectalis sling, for example, it's possible to determine if sphincter conservation is possible. So that's the up and down, the cranial caudal length of the tumor as well, which is important for the radiotherapy planning, and of course, mapping out the distribution of disease. So these are really key points. Then when we're looking at the axial images, particularly in low rectal cancers as well as the sagittal, we want to figure out if the TME plane is safe. If when the surgeon goes down there, that at the very bottom of the dissection, what you don't want is for the surgeon to suddenly find there's tumor there where he wasn't expecting to see it, and then to suddenly have to change from a low anterior section to an APE. So the point about the MRI is you can see the relationship of the advancing edge of the tumor to the floor of the pelvis, and you can decide whether you should do an anterior resection or an extralevator approach, a beyond TME approach. So in those particular instances where it's not going to be possible to do an anterior resection because the TME plane is involved, in those situations, we would advocate preoperative chemoradiotherapy using the MRI to plan the treatment. There is another situation where radiotherapy is a good idea, and that's where the tumor is spreading into the veins in the low rectum, because we know that that is a very frequent pathway of spread for the lateral pelvic sidewall. So we shouldn't just go and do an operation on them, because even if the margins are clear, we know from our data from the Mercury 2 study that that will be associated with a higher risk of local recurrence and positive CRM, by positivity status. The other thing that the radiology can do is measure the depth of tumor. So if the tumor is limited, it's less than 5 millimeters, that's a good prognosis tumor. But if the tumor is spreading out more than 5 millimeters, that means the patient has a risk of developing distant metastases. And what's very interesting is with the radiotherapy, if you go from a high distance, so more than 5 millimeters to less than 5 millimeters, it is the final depth of spread that governs prognosis. So the downstaging of the tumor, and that also applies to the CRM, the tumor takes on the characteristics of the final downstage tumor rather than the original tumor. So it's not like if it's an advanced tumor that the patient's necessarily going to do badly. It depends on the effectiveness of the preoperative treatment, which I'm sure we'll hear about. So I don't want to monopolize the discussion, but that's the sort of summary of some of the key points for staging.
So you know what Dr. Brown told us is MRI not only gives us a lot of information, it correctly stages the tumor, and then it sets the ball rolling for the further management. Thank you very much, Dr. Brown. Again, another question to you. How accurate is MRI in differentiating various stages of the tumor, like from T1 to T2 and to T3 and T3 from T4?
Okay. So I love this question about accuracy, because the accuracy it tends to be judged against the final pathology. Whereas I think maybe if you read some of my papers, we talk about accuracy in a different way. We talk about prognostic accuracy. So that means, are we as good as pathologists at predicting which patients will get local recurrence, which patients will get distant failure, which patients are at risk of other problems? And actually, our prognostic accuracy very often outperforms pathology. And that is particularly the case, for example, in our identification of vascular invasion. As far as T staging goes, the T staging system is not that good. For example, a T1 SM3 and a tumor that's just into the muscularis propria should really be regarded as the same tumor, the same prognosis, same outcome, same treatment. Therefore, to say, oh, MRI is inaccurate because it said it was T2 rather than T1 SM3 would be a fake assessment of accuracy. So I think we have to take into account what we're measuring, what we're seeing, and why we're doing these different staging systems. And I would much rather talk about the depth of spread as it's measured in millimeters, because that actually correlates very precisely with the pathology. And one of the most key things, for example, if you're planning local excision, it's not the T stage, it's how much muscularis is preserved. So if you've got a full thickness of muscularis preserved, it doesn't matter if it's T1 or T2. The fact is you could do a local excision. So those are the sort of principles that I follow and that I advocate others to follow. So don't think about accuracy, think about prognostic accuracy.
I completely agree with you, Dr. Brown. And, you know, we always feel that the radiologist has to be an expert in seeing the images, but also at the same time, they should be clinically inclined, and they need to see the patient in reality, in totality, as you rightly said, that what are we offering this particular patient by labeling this patient as T2 or T3? What is the implication? So as we know already that circumferential section margin is an independent risk factor, and MRI is the best investigation locally to diagnose threatened margins. If the margins are more than 1 millimeter, it is ideal. And if it's less than 1 millimeter, it denotes poor prognostic factors. So which one is the best modality to assess the distant metastasis? There's a lot of talk about, a lot of controversy about PET scan, whether it should be done or not. What is your protocol and how do you see things, Gina?
Yeah, I think we have to use a number of different tools depending on the kind of tumor. So there are situations where the PET is very helpful. And if you look at the primary tumor and it's highly metabolically active, then the chances are the PET will be very sensitive at picking up the distant mets. There are some problems, and we do see this with PET imaging. And I think that one thing we have to be very careful about is things like retroperitoneal lymph nodes, because when we follow some of these patients up, nothing happens. So they might be positive on PET, but it doesn't now mean that the patient is for palliative care. So it's important to give some of the positive PET findings a little bit of the benefit of the doubt and maybe use follow-up and surveillance to decide if this is biologically relevant metastasis. So again, we have to take the whole patient's clinical development into account before saying, oh yes, you know, this patient definitely has metastatic disease. The same applies in the liver. We can very often be fooled in both directions. So sometimes a mucinous tumor can produce cystic mets that are very difficult to pick up on PET, difficult to pick up on MRI. And then you only tell in time that this thing is getting bigger. So there's that situation. Pulmonary nodules, similar problem with pulmonary nodules, because they can be benign granulomatous things. And I'm sure in India with inflammatory and infective changes, it's a perpetual problem. So again, monitoring. So we take an approach where we give patients the benefit of the doubt. If we think that the biology of the tumor is bad, like there's vascular invasion, it's an extensive tumor, our threshold for calling something metastatic disease gets lower. So we are more suspicious. But in a histologically good prognosis tumor, you see something, we might actually just say, okay, let's just see what it really is and how active it is.
Thank you very much. As you very rightly said, in this part of the world, we get a lot of false positive results from PET scan. So I personally tend to avoid doing a PET scan unless it's clinically indicated.
Exactly.
A lot of times in our country, it's the patients who demand, and when they refer to us, we being the tertiary care centers, they already have a PET scan in their hand. Yeah, that's a problem. So coming to Dr. Surupa, who is our radiation oncologist, what are the indications of neoadjuvant treatment, Dr. Surupa, in your practice?
Yeah, so in India, and I think in most of Asian countries, we get the tumors of the rectal cancer patients who are in the advanced stage. Now, when we see rectal cancer patients, in fact, we have been striving to meet a few goals, that is decreasing the local recurrence rate, increasing the survival, both the disease-free and the overall survival, and later on, of course, the organ preservation. And for the surgeons, getting the tumor downstage so that the resectability is better. So these have been the goals of treating rectal cancer by all, whether radiation oncologists, medical oncologists, or surgeons. Now, when we get a cancer patient, and we, like Dr. Gina Brown said, we do the staging. And if we see, there are a few criteria. If they are in the first and the second stage, then these are the cancer patients who can probably achieve all the goals that we have been planning to, or we have been aiming to. But some locally advanced patients, mostly when we see the MRI, if we see the patient with a CRM positive or a CRM threatened, or the extramural vascular invasion is present, or a large tumor, a T3, not all T3 tumors probably, but some T3 tumors, T4B tumors, lymph node invasion. So these are probably a few patients who will not do well without a neoadjuvant treatment. So I would choose these patients for a neoadjuvant treatment, whether it is chemotherapy, chemotherapy, that probably we'll discuss later on.
So perfectly. So what you're trying to say that maybe early tumors, which will fall very clearly into T1, T2 category, may go for upfront surgery, and the tumors which are T3, T4, they probably will fall into the category of neoadjuvant treatment. And I think that's in line with what most of us practice. So the question comes to, you know, ugly T2 tumor and early T3 tumors. That is where I think the gray line is. And I think the United Kingdom has a different protocol as compared to United States. Well, what's your opinion about this, Dr. Paleswan? How do you practice in your country? Then I will have an opinion from Sharad as well. Dr. Paleswan, are you with us? Sharad?
Yes, Dr. Goyal. So as Dr. Swarupa just mentioned that in India, the patients present with locally advanced rectal cancer. Similarly, in Nepal also, patients present with locally advanced rectal cancer. And our policy is to give long course chemoradiotherapy. And I think Dr. Gina beautifully described that the MRI is very important in preoperative staging. So based on MRI, the rectal cancer is categorized into good, bad, and the ugly. I think the late ugly suggests those tumors where the CRM is compromised or it's near the sphincters, so that these patients ideally would not require long course chemo radiotherapy, but in those that are late T2 will require long course chemo radiotherapy, not only for the local control of the disease but also for the sphincter saving surgery, and sometimes they may have complete clinical response and we may achieve organ preservation as well.
So not only to downsize but to downstage the tumor, we would require new adjuvant treatment in early T2 and early T3 tumors. And obviously the practice may differ from particular patient to patient and surgeon to surgeon where they practice. Dr. Sharad, any views on this? How do you choose your patients for new adjuvant in your part of the world?
Yes, so I will take the T3 issue first. So T3, a good T3, so T3A or B, as long as the mesorectal envelope is safe, I think straight to surgery would be the option. T2 is a bit more challenging. I think there is a clinical trial ongoing with us, so I won't go into that, but we do have local excision with radiotherapy as a trial option. But in practical terms, when you say it's ugly, I'm assuming you're saying there is an EMVI or a node or a deposit which is abnormal, and that may swing towards giving new adjuvant treatment. But otherwise, if it's T2 or early T3, straight to surgery.
Anything different, Dr. Mamoon? If there's anything different, I would like your comment.
I totally agree with Sharad. So.
Perfect. Coming back to Dr. Surupa, so what are the indications of short course therapy in your center, in your practice? Normally, most of us will use a long course protocol.
Yeah, now in our hospital, we have all the trials. We all know most of the trials now say there isn't much difference between the short course and the long course treatment, even when it is the toxicity which is concerned, that is the acute toxicity and the also the late toxicities. Acute toxicities are more in the long course treatment, but we were concerned about the late toxicities, which were more supposed to be more in the short course radiation. But what we have seen in the trials and also in the practice, that it is almost the same in the short course and the long course. So ideally, most of the tumors which we indications are almost the same for the short course and the long course. That is T3, again some T3 tumors, T4B tumors. Again, T4B tumors, initially we were not taking, even now we don't take all T4B tumors, very fixed tumors we do not take many times. The tumors which are CRM threatened or CRM positive, the extramural vascular invasion tumors, lymph node positive tumors. So these are the tumors we select for short course and long course both. But especially the tumors which are taken for long course, that is which we generally do not take for short course, these are the tumors which is the low lying. So T4B low lying tumors, these are the tumors many times we avoid because it doesn't give any extra benefit giving the short course treatment, and probably a long course CTRT would be better for these tumors. So the middle rectal tumors, T3 or T4B tumors with MRF invaded, CRM positive or threatened. So these are the tumors which can be selected for short course treatment.
Thank you. Sharad, in your practice, how do you use short course at all? Or if yes, then in which patients?
So that's probably the most difficult question. I think there is a evolving, almost dynamic role for short course. So I think long course is fairly clear for everybody. It is threatened margin. Our threshold to radiotherapy itself is changing. I think we are using less radiotherapy, and that may likely to be because we have a bowel cancer screening program. So we do see fairly early stage disease. So it's not all advanced. So to answer the question short, I think short is mainly when you are unsure in the lower rectum whether the margin is actually threatened. I think Dr. Surupa mentioned that if the MRI can't really be 100% sure, Gina would disagree with that. But in the real world, sometimes it's not easy. The tumor, I think Deep, you mentioned that we can palpate the tumor sometimes, which is tethered, while the MR doesn't necessarily agree. In those situations, I think our threshold to short course is probably lower. During the COVID period, we have used short course in a slightly more innovative way because of resource. And Rapido, which I'm sure the oncologists are excited, we haven't implemented, but we eagerly await that change in protocol.
Thank you. Thank you, Sharad. Dr. Joshi, your views, how do you, practice in your part of the world?
So we in Nepal, we are not practicing short course radiotherapy. We are following only long course chemo radiotherapy for all the indications that has been just discussed.
So in my center, we see a lot of international patients and also a lot of patients coming from outside Delhi. So for the practical purpose, their stay is going to be very long if they're out of their country. So in a good number of selected patients, we use short course treatment and upfront surgery as early as possible. So yes, I think as everybody said and agrees that there are indications and role of short course radiation which is emerging. Asking this question to the surgeons, Sharad again to start with, when would you assess your patient post neoadjuvant treatment?
So now there are two, I didn't mention the short course, but we sometimes do short course with long wait and we reassess at about 10 weeks. But mainly for the long course chemo radiotherapy, we usually do a CT scan and a MRI scan at about 8 to 10 weeks.
Yeah. What about Dr. Mamoon? Any difference in your country?
Actually, we do it in 10 weeks. So I think so. You can do it also even 12 weeks. So we change continuously the process. So 10 weeks we prefer.
Right. Dr. Joshi, what about you? Same?
Yeah, we wait for 8 to 10 weeks.
8 to 10
we
weeks.
Wait for 8 to 10 weeks.
What's your protocol? When would you like to assess your patient after giving radiation? Yeah. As a radiation oncologist?
So since we are practicing short course, but we are started using the delayed surgery. So because we have seen trials which say that immediate surgery, if we compare with the delayed surgery, the complete response rates are much better. And of course, when we look for toxicities, it has been seen in trials that more than 11 weeks, that late toxicities are and the acute toxicities are more. So probably 8 to 10 weeks is the best period for assessing the patient. We do it in about 10 to 11, 10 weeks. For assessing the patient for surgery, and by then we have completed about 3 weeks, three cycles of chemotherapy.
So we know that gone are the days when surgeon used to do whatever in the operation theater and nobody knows what he has done. Today his quality can be measured, and just want to ask Dr. Palaswan and Dr. Sharad, does your pathologist report the quality of a specimen, and as a surgeon, what is your response to this? Dr. Palaswan first and then Dr. Sharad.
So at our institute, the gross quality of the specimen in a fresh specimen is assessed by the surgeon, him or herself, by the photographic documentation, and pathologists assess the quality in the fixed specimen, namely the cross-sectional slices only. So I most of the time I agree with them. I agree with whatever, however they define the grade the quality of our TME specimen.
Good. Dr. Sharad, what's your protocol in your hospital?
Yeah, so our pathologist routinely takes fresh specimen photographs or if not possible, formalized specimen. So they grade the quality of TME and much to our pleasure, I should say, display it publicly. So there is a pressure to perform, which is quite threatening to some of our younger colleagues. But it's a practice we have, and I think it has a positive driver. So it does push us to perform better, take time, get an assistant who's experienced. So sometimes these operations are done as a paired consultant operations, very much eye on the quality of TME, for example. So I think it's a positive driver. It is audited, and it is publicly shared.
I completely agree with you, and I think it strives you to do better and better. And I think it's a very positive thing as far as surgeons are concerned and the patient is concerned. It's transparency that what are we doing in operation theater? Can we be measured? So another, I think, a very controversial question which keeps coming up: how much distal margin for the low rectal cancer is enough, Dr. Sharad?
If you follow the literature, anything up to 0.8 millimeters. But in reality, my practice is I aim for 2 and accept 1. But I would like to say it is not just about the distal margin. So there are tumors, for example, which involve the levator. So you may get a clear distal margin, but the emphasis is on circumferential margin too.
Absolutely. I completely agree. Dr. Mamoon, what's your...
Actually, Sharad nicely explained. So our aim should be 2. But 1 centimeter is acceptable. And as well as I have to try to achieve CRM. So I must have to concentrate on CRM also.
Dr. Palaswan, anything different?
I think I agree with both of them. I don't have anything extra to add in this regards.
So as all of you have said that, you know, presently 2 centimeter rule is accepted and adopted. But as we understand and, you know, the benefits of new adjuvant treatment, distal margins have been shrinking, and at present 1 centimeter margin in a patients where new adjuvant treatment has been given with a favorable histopathology is most accepted, and you know sub-centimeter margins are not recommended out of research protocol. But in some of the patients where their patients are not willing for abdominal perineal resections, we have given them a sub-centimeter margin which are clear obviously histopathologically. And but that should be under, as we said, consent should be taken. Sharad, question to you. Do you do a lot of intestinal dissections and anastomosis, and what are the quality of life issues you deal with them?
So I must admit, I try and do my low rectal anastomosis stapled. There are a very, very small number of cases which are actually suitable for intersphincteric dissection. It's not something that we do often in the UK. But with now robotic platforms coming, I think people are able to push the limits. My simple philosophical take is that just because you can doesn't mean we should. And there is a lot of emphasis here on actually quality of life discussions using what we call a POLAR score, which is essentially predicts the function. So it allows you to take a height of tumor, radiotherapy, gender, and it sort of predicts the function for patients. And I think that's a discussion to have with patients, because a perineal colostomy can be constructed more often than we think, and we have to be careful.
Perfectly. Any comments from anybody about the quality of life issues after colon anastomosis? Dr. Mamoon, Dr. Palaswan, or anybody?
I think so. This should be discussed with the patient. It depends upon the age, sex of the patient. So either he or she is male or female. So number of perity and perineal function and bowel function, what status of the bowel function. So I think so. Lars is a big problem. So I think I have to consult with the patient. Then I have to decide. So if I can do it, then I have to do it. This is no. So this is doing only for my patient to improve the quality of the patient. So if quality of the life is hampered, then probably we should not encourage it.
Perfect. So the message which I am getting that colorectal anastomosis with intersphincter resection should be done in a center where they are routinely doing this kind of surgery, and also where there are post-surgical help is available in terms of counseling, in terms of training, in terms of stoma nurse, which can really guide them and counsel them. Otherwise, it can be a nightmare. And as Sharad said, there are a lot of scores available to assess the quality of life of these patients. And counseling of these patients preoperatively, I think, forms a very, very important part. And one has to be, one has to differentiate between, reality and expectations. So I think there's a huge issue there, which as a surgeon, it's our moral responsibility to counsel these patients preoperatively. So coming to the, very important and something which is new, how do we assess the vascularity of the proximal bowel end most of the times in low anterior resections? And these are some of the new ways indocyanine green is used. And this is how it looks with the near infrared imaging. So I would like to ask Dr. Palaswan, do you routinely use this technology?
we don't have the facility of this ICG fluorescence angiography at our center, so we are not using, but definitely there are many papers, systematic reviews and meta-analysis that suggest that using this ICG fluorescence angiography definitely decreases the anastomotic leak and the subsequent complications.
Anything would you like to add, Dr. Mamoon? Is it available in your country? Do you use it?
No, actually, I'm not also using it. So I think so. If anyone using it, so regular basis, then he should use it. Otherwise, there will be some problems. And one important thing, so in the area of laparoscopy and robotic surgery, so this is a very good technique, I think. So if you have the opportunity, so use it regularly and it will give you a better result.
Sharad, any comments from you? Do you use it regularly?
We are in a poor country, so I have put the business case in. We're waiting for money.
So let me say that I belong to a very rich country and we regularly use it. And especially as Dr. Mamoon said, in robotic platform and in laparoscopy, it is very handy. Sometimes it is sometimes very difficult to be completely sure of the vascularity in some of the cases. And it is very, very helpful to know the vascularity. And these are some of the papers which Dr. Palaswan was mentioning, that in this particular paper, what they have shown is 504 patients were taken into consideration and 5.8% of the patients did not have any leak in which ICG was used. So clearly it shows that this is an important tool which can be useful. Similarly, in the Pillar 2 trial, 147 prospective trial, where they said that total anastomotic leak rate was 1.4%, and this technology was used in 8% of the patient where, the 8% patient, the resection line was changed. And in cases where resection line was changed, there was no leak found. So clearly it seems that this is a useful technique to use in selected patients. Coming to another technical point, surgery, is there any difference between high ligation and low ligation during the surgery? And does it make any difference to the patient or to the surgeon? Dr. Palaswan.
So high ligation, we all know that it is ligating the inferior mesenteric artery after the takeoff of the left colic artery. And as compared to high ligation, it was thought that it is oncologically not safe because the nodal yield will be less. However, studies have shown that low ligation and high ligations are oncologically equally safe. However, the defecatory function and genitourinary function are said to be better with the low ligation as compared to the high ligation. And the randomized controlled trial that was published in Annals of Surgery, which is also known as high-low trial, suggests that the genitourinary functions are better with the low ligation. However, the anastomotic leak rate is not high with high ligation as well, as it was thought that the vascularity of the colon is compromised when the inferior mesenteric artery is ligated before the takeoff of left colic artery.
Thank you, Dr. Joshi.
We go for low ligation of inferior mesenteric artery.
Dr. Mamoon, what is your philosophy?
Actually, so this is a debatable area. So I think so high ligation, we can do high ligation. So, but regarding high ligation, so you have the some regarding oncological outcome, there is no difference, but there is probably some prognostic below. So there may be skip metastasis in the nodal involvement, skip nodal involvement and the root of the IME. So in that since high ligation may be preferred. So in case of for anastomotic, tension-free anastomosis, so high ligation can be done.
Sharad, what's your view about this?
Yes, so I'm selective. I do it case by case. So I decide on table what is the safest thing to do. I like to preserve the nerve plexus. So if it is easily possible by doing a high ligation, I will do a high ligation. If not, I'll preserve the left colic for better supply anyway.
Yeah, I think that's what we follow. But most of the now we have realized lately, since last 4 or 5 years, that most of the times we end up doing low ligation. but we completely denude the origin of the vessel, take all the lymph nodes from there, and but we ligate after the left colic vessel is given. And there is some evidence in literature which says that, you know, colonic ischemia and anastomotic leak rates are higher in high ligation group, but the functional outcomes are better in low ligation group. And another trial which Dr. Joshi was just mentioning, that continence, obstructive urinary symptoms, sexual functions are better in low ligation group as shown in a high-low trial, but there is not much difference in the anastomotic leak rate. Coming to another controversial topic, what is the protocol in your department, Sharad? Whether you are you very sure that you want to make a stoma in this particular patient or no? Is there a protocol which you follow, or you go case by case?
It's mainly case by case, but pretty much anybody who's had radiotherapy for the rectal cancer will have a proximal defunctioning stoma. And I'm aware that different parts of the world practice a different type of stoma. We do a loop ileostomy here. A misfired gun or a technically difficult operation is occasional no radiotherapy set where we may proximally defunction. But all patients undergoing rectal surgery are counseled for having a potentially temporary stoma.
Dr. Mamoon, any difference in your protocols?
No, actually, after neoadjuvant therapy, so almost all patients undergo low pilostomy. So if any patients below the peritoneal reflections undergo low anterior resection, so we do practice stoma, because this is for the safety of the surgeon. You have to save your skin also. So for the safeguard of the patient.
But what do you think, Dr. Mahmoud, by making a stoma, are you reducing the chances of leak? Or
I think so. There is evidence. So, ileostomy stoma can decrease the chance of leakage, but cannot prevent. So, stoma cannot prevent, but it prevent the consequences of the peritonitis. So, if you go for a stoma, so you can save the patient. So, probably you don't go for further laparotomy or intervention.
Dr. Palaswan, what are your views? Does the stoma formation reduces the chances of anastomotic leak, or it is just that as Dr. Abdullah said?
I think initially everybody thought that it decreases the consequences of anastomotic leak, but over the period of time, various studies have shown that it not only it decreases the anastomotic leak as leak as well. And there is a level one evidence published in Journal of Gastrointestinal Oncology in 2018, where they showed that the anastomotic leak decreased significantly as well as the reoperation rate. So it definitely decreases the anastomotic leak, not just the consequences of anastomotic leak.
I would agree with you, and there are trials available, level one evidence, as you rightly said, to prove this, that making a stoma does reduce the chances of leak. Coming to some special situations, how would you treat an obstructed upper rectal cancer? What are the strategies? Would you stent them, or you would take up their first stage surgeries? How would you do them, Sharad?
Yes, so these are difficult territories. So, obstructing the rectal tumor is, in my practice, defunctioned. So, we have done the whole circle on this. Rather than doing primary surgery, I would defunction this. Stents are very often not possible because the lower end of the stent may cause problems. But a higher tumor, yes, potential stent, but otherwise just defunction. And then manage the rectal cancer like you would.
Yeah. I am a huge fan of stenting upper rectal obstructed tumors because it gives you an opportunity to reduce a lot of morbidity in these patients. And we have now a series of around 23 cases over a period of 8 years. And we are very happy with it. Contrary to what some of the literature suggests, that, you know, putting in a stent can cause micro perforations and maybe upstage the tumor. But I think in our practice, we find it very, very useful because the benefits are huge. You know, you're avoiding laparotomies, you're avoiding recurrent surgeries, and when you do laparotomies in these messy situations, wound infection, incisional hernias, stoma, increased hospital stay. But yes, as you rightly said, that in proper cases, obviously it is not possible in all cases, but whenever possible, I think stents have been a savior. Coming to some of our last slides, as we know that this is a very, very exciting area which has been, you know, developed, complete clinical response And there is a group of patients who show complete clinical response and pathological response. They can be put into a wait and watch group, as was shown by Angelita Hibagama from Brazil. And at this point of time, they are being used in research protocols. But I would like to know response from all of you, starting from Gina. What are your views and what do you think is the future? Very quickly, because now we are, I think, running short.
Okay. So we're doing a clinical trial for patients who are going to need chemoradiotherapy anyway because they have advanced rectal cancer. And those patients are getting chemorads, and they're being randomized between a control arm of straight to surgery versus a TRG, MRTRG assessment. So if you have a good tumor regression grade on MRI, they get offered watch and wait, irrespective of the clinical findings, biopsy findings, or anything else. And if they have a poor response, they get consolidation chemotherapy and then a re-review. So that's our approach. We're not in favor of giving radiotherapy to early stage tumors as an upfront approach, because we believe that that's over-treatment. And also, if there's a T1 tumor or an early T2, that could just as easily be treated by local excision. So you could still have a sphincter-saving approach without necessarily needing radiotherapy until maybe as an adjuvant treatment if they've got poor risk features. So that's our approach to maximize sphincter conservation. So the watch and wait is a trial because TRG on MRI, it does not correlate with pathology at all. Most of the patients with a good TRG end up having residual tumor if you operate on them. So the control arm patients, there's very few complete responses in advanced tumors, yet 40% of our patients are being put into watch and wait with advanced cancers. So this is why we have to do it in a clinical trial.
Right. My question to Sharad is that, and Sarupa both, that if you have a patient whom you see there is a complete response, would you offer him out of research protocol wait and watch policy after discussing with the patient pros and cons? Would you offer him at all or no?
Yeah, actually, this is a very difficult topic, and it is really difficult to push the patient for a permanent back. So when such patient come, I have in mind the previous tumor, what was the tumor size, what was the tumor space, and the second is that whether the response is a true complete response or not, to be very sure whether it is a true complete response or not with the help of MRI and maybe an endoscopy.
Yes,
and if there is a residual tumor, probably a biopsy and a biopsy need to be done. But at the same time, we don't follow up or not. Many times, these kind of patients, they just flee. So we need to take their confidence and to see that they can stay on follow-up. But right now, outside clinical trial, or unless and until the patient insists, I would say that they need to start on wait and watch trial policies.
Thank you, Dr. Sarupa. Sharad, what are your views?
Exciting territory. I think this will be topics for conferences to come. In the real world, my view is that if the assessment is going to be a point assessment, it's probably not worth testing. But if you have access to patients' follow-up and you can have a structured follow-up, I think if the patient chooses, you are quite safe. Because if you trust Hibagama's data, then there is nothing lost in terms of waiting and delaying the operation. So that I have an open discussion with the patient.
Dr. Abdullah, any different views? And Dr. Joshi, any different views?
Actually, I think I agree with whatever has been said.
Right. Dr. Moon?
So, I do agree. But if the patient is, in our practice, if the patient is fit for surgery, so I'll go for surgery. I'll offer him. So, if the patient is very old and the patient is not accepting stroma or radical surgery, then probably he can wait.
But I am of a slightly different opinion. As a surgeon, it is my duty to give all the options to my patient and also counsel him about what is happening, that this protocol is at the moment under research, is not being used for the clinical practice, but results are encouraging. And I am happy to put you in this in this group of patients, as long as Sharad said, if you're willing to follow up, and as long as you understand the risks involved. And if the patient chooses to do so, I'm happy to put him on the wait and watch list. That's my personal opinion. But not offering him, not telling him that this kind of a treatment protocol is being developed, and probably I think it's my personal view that this is going to be the future for patients who will respond. And as more and more therapies and type of therapies are coming, I am sure that our response rate is going to increase from 20% to more. So as Sharad said, this is a very, very exciting area, and one should explore this. So I think I would like to end and thank all of you for joining me for this exciting panel discussion. And as we all know, once you are a surgeon, you are a student for your lifetime, and I am learning all the time. The tombstone will be my diploma, as was said by Artha Kitt. And thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for joining me. Together everyone achieves more. And on behalf of IHS and Royal College of Edinburgh, I thank you all once again. Thank you very much. Stay safe. See you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So we have some time for question answers, and there are some questions which has been put on the Q&A. I will take it one by one. Somebody is asking that what are the precautions taken to prevent serositis in an ileostomy? Sharad, would you like to take that question? Sharad, yeah. What are the precautions taken to prevent serositis in an ileostomy?
I think what they mean is serositis as in inflammation around the stoma. And I think it is technical aspects. I think adequate supply and not having enough tension, adequate spout is probably what it requires.
Right. Another question to you, Sharad, is that what is the incidence of anastomotic leak in low anterior resection in open versus lap versus robotic? Is there any difference?
I think the initial data from laparoscopic was to suggest that there was a slightly higher risk of anastomotic leak, but I'm sure these are function of the learning curve. I think the leak rate remains in the territory of 5 to 10%. I suppose in robotic TATME, the incidence rates will probably evolve in time, but they will probably settle at around 5 to 10%.
I would agree. I think it's not the technology which we use which will dictate the leak of the anastomosis. I think it's the surgical principles which we follow. If our anastomosis is under tension, if the anastomosis is not well vascularized, then the chances of leak are higher. And obviously, if we fail to recognize the high-risk patients and we do not create a stoma in these patients, obviously the leak rate is going to be higher in those patients rather than blaming any one technology. I think once you have mastered a technology, I don't think that the rate of anastomotic leak would be make any significant difference. Anybody else want to make a comment on this? Dr. Mamoon, Dr. Paleswan, or any of the surgeons? Okay, I think with this we have finished with the question and answers, and I will hand over the mic back to Dr. Anil Harur. Anil, over to you. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Deep, and thank you so much for finishing in time.